shall suddenly come to his temple. The one shall suddenly come to his temple. And again, this is not referring to a natural building, referring to a Jewish temple. It's not a parable or a tabernacle. It's referring to a true temple of God. God is going to come, he's going to reveal himself to his people. So, even if he denies me, he shall come, said the Lord. But if they lie to me, he shall stand when you
So in Malachi, he's speaking about the Lord shall suddenly come to his temple, and who shall abide the day of his coming. He will be like refiner's fire and the fuller's soap, and he shall sit as a refiner and purifier of silver. And I'm telling you this, I believe that the coming of the Lord, the appearing of the Lord, that we ought to be looking for, is that coming of the Lord that's going to do the purifying, that's going to do the refining, that's going to burn out all of the stuff, the dross, that only that which is of God and that which is of divinity remains. So that's what's referring to here. And it says, and he shall purify the sons of Levi and purge them as gold and silver, that they may offer unto the Lord an offering in righteousness. Now, it didn't say that the first ones that are going to be dealt with are going to be the lay member or the congregation or just John or Joe out on the street, but it's going to begin with the priesthood. It's going to begin with the leadership. And then, of course, the scripture tells us that judgment shall begin at the house of the Lord. In other words, that is where the visitation of God is going to come. And let me just share one other scripture with you in Numbers chapter 10. Numbers chapter 10. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, make thee two trumpets of silver. Of a whole piece shalt thou make them, that thou mayest use them for the calling of the assembly and for the journeying of the camps. And when they shall blow with them, all the assembly shall assemble themselves to thee at the door of the tabernacle of the congregation. And if they blow but with one trumpet, then the princes, which are heads of the thousand of Israel, shall gather themselves unto thee. When you blow an alarm, then the camps that lie on the east part shall go forward. When you blow an alarm the second time, then the camps that lie on the south side shall take their journey. They shall blow an alarm for their journey. Now here's my whole point. The point being that there were two trumpets that were made out of one piece of silver. The blowing of the first trumpet was for the specific calling forth of the leaders, the princes. And then the second was for the gathering of the whole congregation. The scripture teaches us that if a trumpet gives an uncertain sound, how will anyone know to prepare themselves for whatever is transpiring? In other words, if you don't hear a clear sound of the trumpet, how are you going to know how to respond? And so it's very important that we know distinctively what the trumpet is saying. It's very important that we know what the word of the Lord is and how that we can hear and discern the word of the Lord. But the first trumpet is for the gathering of the leaders. And this is what is happening here in David gathering. First of all, the priests and the Levites. Now, in 1 Chronicles 15, 16 through 24, he is calling forth for the order of the singers and the musicians. And David spake to the chief of the Levites to appoint their brethren to be the singers with instruments of music, psalteries, and harps and cymbals, sounding by lifting up the voice with joy. So the Levites appointed Heman, the son of Joel, and of his brethren, Asaph. And keep that, make a note of that. I want you to make either a natural note or a mental note. Keep in mind Asaph. The other name that I want you to take note of is Zadok and Asaph. Asaph, the son of Berechiah and of the sons of Merari, and their brethren, Ethan the son of Cushiah, and with them their brethren of the second degree, Zechariah, Ben, and Jaziel, and Shemaramoth, and Jehiel, and Uni, and Eliab, and Benaiah, and Maaseiah, and Mathathiah, and Eliphelet, oh my goodness, and Mikneiah, and Obed-Edom. Now, you might want to make a note of that name also. I'm going through all this and just telling you to make a note of a certain one. Okay, Obed-Edom, I want you to take note of that because he was a significant player in all of this. And Jehiel, the porters. So the singers, Heman, Asaph, and Ethan were appointed to sound with cymbals of brass. And Zechariah, and Aziel, and Shemaramoth, and Jehiel, and Uni, and I'm not even going to read all those, with psalteries. And these other guys with harps to excel, and these other guys for song. And I want you to take note of two words here. In verse 21, it says to excel. And then in verse 22, it speaks about their being skillful. Now, I think it's very important. I believe that God desires that we excel. And I believe that he intends for us to be skillful. I understand that you can make a joyful noise before the Lord. And if that's all you know how to do, if all you know how to do is just make a loud noise, make a loud noise. But I believe that what God is looking for is excellence. And what he's looking for is skillfulness. And guess what? Neither one comes by accidentally. It does not come about just because you want it to or hope that it will be. But you have to apply yourself. You have to work at it. Which means that if you're going to be a part of the praise and worship, you might have to go to rehearsal. You may have to practice. If you're going to be a skillful pianist or guitarist, you need to practice. It's important that you do whatever you do with skillfulness and with excellence. And there were those who were doorkeepers of the ark. And there were those who blew the trumpet. So the whole point here, of course, being that every man, and unfortunately it looks like here no women mentioned. I'm not even going to try to explain that. That Old Testament. That's all you can say, I guess. But every man or every woman in his or her own place, abide in the calling wherein you have been called. Be faithful to that calling, and God will reward you accordingly. The whole point being that we all function as a corporate body, and there is no completeness unless everyone takes his or her rightful place. Every joint fitly framed together, every joint supplying. And one cannot say to the other, have no need of thee. How can the hand say to the eye or the ear, I have no need of thee? We have a need for every single part of the body. Each had their particular function in the dedicatory service of the tabernacle of David. There were those who ministered before the ark and to record. See, you didn't think they had CDs and audio tapes then. Well, they did. But they did have a means of recording. And I think it's very, very important that we record the word of the Lord. If God speaks a word, if God speaks a prophetic word, it's good that we have a recording of it. And of course, their recording was writing. And to thank and praise the Lord God of Israel, Asaph the chief, and next to him all these other guys, with psalteries, with harps. But Asaph made a sound with cymbals. Now, Asaph is the chief musician. He is the chief praise and worship leader. And when you go over to the book of Psalms, you will find that there were many psalms written by Asaph. Now, Asaph didn't have something that would be glamorous. I wouldn't think of cymbals as being as glamorous as a trumpet or the keyboard. But he had his skill, he had his calling, and he fulfill that. Now, this is beautiful. Verse 7 says, then on that day, David delivered first this psalm to thank the Lord into the hand of Asaph and his brethren. Give thanks unto the Lord. This is one of the powerful scriptures. This is one of the powerful psalms, and has several key thoughts. Give thanks unto the Lord, call upon his name, make known his deeds among the people. Sing unto him, sing psalms unto him, talk ye of all his wondrous works. Glory ye in his holy name. Let the heart of them rejoice that seek the Lord. Seek the Lord in his strength. Seek his face continually. Remember his marvelous works that he hath done, his wonders and the judgments of his mouth. O ye seed of Israel, his servant, ye children of Jacob, his chosen ones, he is the Lord our God. His judgments are in all the earth. Be ye mindful always of his covenant, the word which he commanded to a thousand generations. I think we've already dealt with this, if we haven't. A thousand here, I don't believe, represents a finite number, meaning that God is not going to command his covenant to a thousand generations and cut it off and say, oops, you missed the cutoff. You're the thousand and first generation. By the same token, you cannot say that God is limited by owning a cattle on 1,000 hills. I don't believe he can put a finite number. I mean, it 2,000, 3,000. And the point being here, I think that it talks about a long period of time. You're talking about, in fact, the kingdom of God is not just for 1,000 years. The kingdom of God is forever and ever. Daniel said it is an eternal kingdom. Even of the covenant which he made, you can find something in almost in every word. He made with Abraham, and of his oath unto Isaac, and hath confirmed the same to Jacob for a law. So he has made a covenant with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob for a law. But to Israel for an everlasting covenant, which means that God's covenant with us extends beyond the law. Jacob represented the natural. Israel represents the spiritual. Jacob was the unregenerated. Israel was the regenerated. Jacob was the deceiver. Israel was a prince with God. And you may say, well, you know, the same man. Well, he may have looked like the same on the outside, but he was a totally different person. By the same token, you can't look at me and to say and to be able to describe everything that's on the inside of me unless it's revealed to you by the Spirit. Now, you may be able to read a person's countenance and tell whether they're sad, whether they're happy or full of joy, or whether they have peace, or whether they're anxious. I mean, there are a lot of things that we can see by observation. You cannot tell whether a person is, quote, holy by the way they look, by their hairstyle, or by their style of dress, or whether they have something on or something off. And we have measured people's righteousness and their holiness by their appearance. But God does not look on the outward, he looks on the inward, and he knows the intent of the heart. Unto thee will I give the land of Canaan, the lot of your inheritance, when you were but few, even a few, and strangers in it, and when they went from nation to nation, and from one kingdom to another people. He suffered no man to do them wrong. Yea, he reproved kings for their sake, saying, touch not mine anointed, and do my prophets no harm. And this is not just talking about the preacher in the pulpit. It's not just talking about a prophet that gets up and prophesies from the platform and whatever else that we do to exalt man. but the anointed of the Lord can be a little house mother or a little grandmother or someone that may not be of any significance. You better not lay your hand on any of God's anointed, and don't do his prophets any harm. Sing unto the Lord, all the earth. Show forth from day to day his salvation. Declare his glory among the heathen, his marvelous works among all nations. For great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised. He also is to be feared above all gods. For all the gods of the people are idols, but the Lord made the heavens. Glory and honor in his presence. Strength and gladness are in his place. Give unto the Lord, ye kindreds of the people. Give unto the Lord glory and strength. Give unto the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering and come before him. Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Now, 50 years ago, all we knew to sing in church was when we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that would be. Or to Canaan's land, I'm on my way. And all those are okay, you know. They blessed us then anyway, and some of them still bless us. But then there came this refreshing movement of spirit that renewed true praise and worship to the Lord. And I remember perhaps for the first time, maybe ever in my Christian experience, I heard the word of the Lord being sung. And I think this was at a Full Gospel Businessmen's Fellowship back many years ago. But there was this renewal and this outpouring of God's Spirit that renewed this spirit of worship. And really what he was doing was rebuilding the tabernacle of David. But the psalms and the word of the Lord, it was sung. And the truth is that I remember much of the Word of God because I remember singing those. And I'm just thinking here, give unto the Lord, all ye people, give unto the Lord. The glory due his name, give unto the Lord. Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Well, I remember that. Okay. So when the ark began to move, David, the king, the leader, the commander, went first, then the elders of Israel, the captains of Israel, then the high priest, specifically Zadok and Abiathar, the chiefs and Levites, seven trumpeters, two doorkeepers, and then the ark of the Lord. The singers went first, then the players on instruments, and weaving in and out amongst them were the damsels playing their timbrels. The congregation followed in the glorious procession. You know, when I get involved in this, just so many things come to my mind, and I come to class and think, well, I don't know whether I got enough material here, and before you know it, you only halfway through and the time's gone. And just so many things, it reminds you of something that's transpired. Yesterday, I got an email from a classmate of mine. We just had our 50th class reunion. And she sent forwarded an email, and I absolutely despise people forwarding emails to me. You know, some people, that's all they can do. That's all they do all day long, I guess, and they load down your mailbox. But she prefaced this by saying, I don't often send forward emails, but I thought this was so fantastic that I just had to pass this along. And so I clicked on it, and it was, they have this GodTube. You know, have YouTube, and I think they have GodTube, which I guess is just Christian stuff. I clicked on it, and it was a video, about a 5-minute video, of these kids doing their dance to a song. I don't even recall the name of the song, but it was precisely what our kids here did locally. And here was this young lady, well, she's not a young lady, this woman, who was brought up in a Pentecostal church all of her life. She was involved in, quote, praise and worship, singing, special singing, And apparently, this was the first time she ever saw anyone dancing to Christian music in a church. And I haven't responded to her yet, and I want to be careful how I respond to her, because the truth of the matter, our kids did a much greater, a more awesome job here than what was on that video. And I don't know if some of you remember the song where Malachi, you know, taking, you know, pulling them up the mountain, you know, and the kids are, you know, running, climbing over everything, and the Lord just keep drawing them. And the point here being that it's awesome what God is doing in the midst of his people that back a few years ago would have been unthinkable. I mean, we would have thought it was absolutely sinful to do any kind of choreographed dancing in church. I remember Oral Roberts back in the 70s when he polished up his TV program, and some people said he made it too much Hollywood, and he'd bring in these celebrities, and they would have these choreographers who would dance. And boy, he was absolutely persecuted. He was a trailblazer. I mean, it was on the cutting edge of a new form of worship in the church. But it's awesome when you realize what God is doing in terms of praise and worship. And again, I say that I believe it's all part of the restoration of the tabernacle of David. Because when you read in the Word of the Lord in this context, and you see how that God so meticulously has pulled out these trumpeters and these who play the cymbals and those that play the stringed instruments and the dancing. It says, even what it says, it spoke about the, where are we at? Oh, okay. The singers went first, the players on the instruments, and weaving in and out among them the damsels playing their timbrels. The congregation followed in the glorious procession. And I believe as the damsels just weaved their way in and out, I believe they were dancing before the Lord. They were dancing before the Lord with all their might. It's kind of funny how that people say, well, I'm not going to dance unless the Spirit moves upon me. Well, that's almost like saying I'm not going to raise my hands unless the Spirit moves upon me, or I'm not going to clap my hands unless the Spirit moves upon me, or I'm not even going to sing unless the Spirit moves upon me. Well, you know, Paul said, I will sing in the Spirit, and I will sing with my understanding. In other words, there's a time that we just sing because we know it's the proper thing to do. It doesn't necessarily mean that something has overwhelmed you and taken hold of you and shook you and said, do it. And the same thing I believe is true. Yes, I remember the excitement, you know, going to church on Sunday night back when I was a kid. And little brother Branch, a little bitty guy, but he probably went over 5'2". And he was an absolute ball of fire. And the church service would get going and music would get going. And everybody would turn and